Thank you, Chairman Gardner, and thank you, Ranking Member Cardin, as well, for this opportunity to appear before you today to testify on the very, very important and timely issue of democratic transitions in Southeast Asia. Let me thank the subcommittee for its continued leadership in advancing U.S. interests and values and promoting overall engagement with the Asia-Pacific region. Your work serves as another high-profile demonstration of the expanded involvement of the United States in the region and an important reminder that human rights and democracy are universal values, not just American ones. The U.S. government's rebalance to Asia and the Pacific region recognizes that our future prosperity and security are inextricably tied to the region. It reflects the importance we place on our economic and strategic engagement, as well as our strong support for advancing democracy, good governance, justice, and human rights. These goals, in our view, are mutually reinforcing elements of a unified strategy that at its core is about strengthening our relationships with the people of the region and their governments. When assessing democratic transition in the region, I think we agree with the assessment that both of you have offered, that there's some good news and there's some bad news. There are now more Southeast Asians living under democratic rule than was the case 30 years ago. Democracy has taken root in countries like the Philippines and Indonesia, and in countries like Burma, there have been important steps towards full democratic rule. At the same time, there is not so good news. In countries like Thailand, Cambodia, and Malaysia, we have seen backsliding of late. And of course, millions of other Southeast Asians in countries like Laos and Vietnam continue to live under repressive and authoritarian governments. So the democratic picture in the region is mixed. Nevertheless, we remain committed to the notion that effective and accountable governance and respect for the rule of law and human rights provide the foundation for long-term political stability and sustainable development, and thus they are a cornerstone of our approach to the region as a whole, just as they are in the rest of the world. Our democracy engagement in Southeast Asia is characterized by three key objectives. First, the strengthening of civil society. Second, encouraging government transparency and accountability. And third, increasing access to information. First, on strengthening civil society, in his remarks before the UN General Assembly in September, President Obama noted, quote, "When civil society thrives, communities can solve problems that governments cannot necessarily solve alone," close quote. Southeast Asia is home to a vibrant and active civil society with which we work closely through efforts like the Young Southeast Asian Leaders Initiative. We also employ grassroots, results-oriented programming across the region to empower local civil society organizations. Our programs have trained labor activists, brought human rights principles to security forces, strengthened elections mechanisms, and empowered citizen journalists to connect, share, and publish their work. And our rapid response mechanisms have enabled us to provide immediate relief and assistance to both individual activists and civil society organizations when they are under threat. Still, the region has not been immune to the worldwide crackdown on civil society. In Thailand, for instance, the military regime has restricted civil liberties, including freedom of association, since seizing power in May 2014. And in Cambodia recently, the government adopted legislation limiting the ability of non-governmental organizations to operate freely. Despite these tightening restrictions on civil society, new tools have enabled governments to become more open and accountable in the region, which is our second goal for our engagement there. In the Philippines, for instance, grassroots participation in the planning and budgeting of poverty reduction programs in every one of its municipal and provincial governments has resulted in greater citizen involvement and better tailored policies for communities. The Philippines undertook this effort as a founding member of the Open Government Partnership, a multilateral initiative in which the United States and Indonesia were also founding members. We will continue to push to expand participation in the OGP initiative throughout the region. Nevertheless, we recognize that initiatives like OGP only work if citizens are able to share information openly and freely. This is why increasing access to information is the third element in our democracy strategy for the region. We believe that access to information and freedom of expression are important indicators of a democracy's health. A free and open internet, as well as an independent press, are instrumental to, for example, rooting out corruption and increasing government accountability. Governments in Southeast Asia are grappling with how to manage the flow of information with the explosive internet growth, as well as new communication tools. And we are troubled by what appears to be backsliding in some countries on these issues. In Malaysia, for instance, approximately 30 government critics have been charged under its sedition law, a law, by the way, which Prime Minister Najib once publicly committed to eliminating. So we face challenges and opportunities in this area as well. In conclusion, Mr. Chairman, the region encompasses a range of countries at different places in the transition to democracy, some moving in the right direction, others not. A common thread between them, though, is that their people are increasingly demanding more from their governments, better services, more transparency, and a greater role in the fundamental decisions that shape their lives. The Department of State will continue to support these aspirations, and backed by congressional support, we believe that democracy can further take root and expand throughout the region. Thank you very much.